In these uncertain economic times, you've got to do whatever you can to save money. One of our biggest expenses can be our cars, especially when unexpected repair bills hit. Not anymore. If you own a vehicle with less than 130,000 miles, is less than 12 years old, has a warranty about to expire, or even no warranty at all, you could stop paying for car repairs. Roadside assistance, towing, and rental coverage are all included. Don't wait for the next repair. Make one free call right now to see if you qualify. If your vehicle is less than 12 years old, has less than 130,000 miles, even if it's out of warranty, paying for car repairs can become a thing of the past. Call us right now and get your car protected before your next repair bill hits. Get protection and no more repair bills. Call 800-696-1030. Again, 800-696-1030. That's 800-696-1030. 800-696-1030.
Joe had huge problems with the IRS.
I knew it was coming. I hadn't filed taxes since 1990.
All the IRS letters coming in added up to a nightmare.
To get up to like $68,000, my heart started beating fast. It's like, there's no way, man. I mean, I ain't gonna be able to do this.
Then they stopped his paycheck.
So that's when I started making phone calls and found U.S. Tax Shield.
U.S. Tax Shield went to work immediately.
They just took the bull by the horns. What blew my mind is he called the IRS right then and there.
So why is U.S. Tax Shield A-plus rated with the Better Business Bureau? Joe knows.
They saved me a ridiculous amount of money.
If you owe more than $10,000 to the IRS or state, choose the company Joe chose, U.S. Tax Shield.
It was the best decision I made. U.S. Tax Shield is the way to go. Life is good. Thank you, Lord.
Call 800-471-3287.
U.S. Tax Shield. Boo-rah. Yes.
800-471-3287. 800-471-3287.
K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we're expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at advertise@k98talk.org. K98talk.com, a leader in internet radio. So grab your seatbelts and take the ride of your life on K98talk.com.
Hey, jingety-jing, it's Dominic the Donkey, jingety-jing, the Italian Christmas donkey, la la la, la 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 la. La 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 la.
That is my favorite Christmas song, and so I thought that we would open with that because, quite frankly, I'm sick to death of Intergalactic, and I'm sure everybody else is as well. I really hate that song, so I thought, why not?
I have to agree with you. However, my favorite Christmas song is Feliz Navidad.
That can be next week.
Awesome!
Yeah, I want to do one a week.
Because, you know, I celebrate Christmas.
Okay, I celebrate Festivus. I get the pole out of the attic. And
I don't want there.
You've never seen that Seinfeld episode?
I think when Seinfeld was in its, I don't know, I think I was in college or finishing college and was just done with college, and I was going out and doing stuff instead of watching TV, so I missed all that.
Well, I was a freshman in high school and I didn't have a car, but I did have a pack of cigarettes, a nickel bag, and some Mountain Dew, so I would sit and watch Seinfeld.
Yeah.
And Actually,
I mean, I've seen plenty of episodes of it because it is good and because I'm sort of Elaine. Or so I've been told. So I have to say that the one episode with the ugly baby, I thought was completely exaggerated, right? Until I actually saw an ugly baby once. Oh, Lord. Because people say, oh, yeah, babies are ugly when they're born, you know, but then they get better looking, they, you know, start looking like humans. But no, I've seen babies like preemies, you know, just born, and they are ridiculously adorable. Just amazing.
Amazing. Ugly babies look like shaved chihuahuas.
But this baby that I saw in the store was ugly. And I was.
My babies like, from stores? That might be your first problem.
No, I was in there shopping. And
for a baby.
This guy was there toting his newborn along with him. And I happened to get a glance at the baby because I was like, oh, it's a little baby. And then, oh, God. Yeah.
Nope.
I was
disgusting.
Yeah, I was very. I felt bad. Like, I am that person. I am that, you know, horrible person that thinks a baby is ugly.
That's okay. You know who else is an ugly baby?
Donald Trump.
Yes, but that's not who I was talking about. Speaking of, okay, I'm just gonna say it. The president of the United States is a feckless retard.
Oh God,
he's just retarded. There's no. He's either incredibly naive, or he's just retarded. There's no way, there is absolutely no way in my imagination, in reasonable society where you can get up on a dais and equate a terrorist movement of thousands of people with billions of dollars spreading across 3 or 4 countries and operating in every continent in the world except Antarctica, and say, this is a lot like global warming. It's just, it doesn't happen.
I have to say that, like, my younger brother is borderline mentally retarded.
But that doesn't matter.
So I think this is a little unfair to retarded people. So.
Yeah, because he might actually, now here's the thing. I have friends who are actually stupid. Even they don't understand how terrorism has anything to do. I mean, I'll give you a really great example. This guy that I know, I'm not going to say what his name is or whatever, but I was talking to him the other day in a business that he owns, and he is an incredibly low info voter, lower than most anyone can be. And he says to me the other day, can you explain to me what terrorism has to do with global warming? And I said, I couldn't tell you. And he goes, you know what's really weird? And I said, what? He goes, neither can I.
Well, neither can the president. I mean, he has no direct correlation to show us. He just gets up there and talks and acts really put out that he has to talk about this stuff because we're interfering with his golfing.
Yeah. And, you know, here's the thing. Now, let's assume, okay.
And it's not even us that's interfering with his golfing. But the fact that we want him to do something. Well, and I think it really is our fault. If, you know, you think about it. We expect him to do something. Like, what's he going to do? He doesn't have the His charisma is not ass beating. His charisma is cool dude who shows up with an attitude and tells people, I want to deal with it.
Yeah. I mean, that's, you hit the nail right on the head. It's the, I mean, Obama is almost a parody of every stodgy, elitist, progressive on the planet. They're offended that you're too stupid to understand this. It's offensive to them that you don't understand what they're saying. Because it doesn't make any sense.
Well, I understand what they're saying, but what they're saying doesn't have any correlation to terrorism. That's like that.
It doesn't, because if it did, half of the state of California would be terrorists. Parts of China and India would be rampant with terrorism.
I don't even know what you mean.
What about Australia? Australia's 40% desert. You know, and now here, my low info friend says to me, I don't understand how there's a link between terrorism and global warming. And I said, well, I don't either. And so he goes into this rant and he goes, what the fuck? What are you going to tell me that people who live in a desert, like, you know, temperature, it's, you know, 3 degrees hotter here now. My carrots won't grow. I guess I'll just become a suicide bomber. Like, what?
I want to know who gave him these insights into the terrorist's mind. Because if that's the case, we just need to get him down to Gitmo and do some mind reading. And, absorb the information for us and then spit it out. But if it's all like global warming crap, then we know that he's just blown it out of his ass.
Why aren't there any other people becoming terrorists? Why is it that climate change seems only to affect Arabs? Or more specifically, Muslims? Why does climate change only seem to affect them towards becoming terrorists or extremists or violent? Why don't we see huge, you know, mass shootings in China or India or parts of South America? Why don't we see it there?
Well, I think it's
poverty and destitution and bad climate are what caused these events. I mean,
I think you've hit the nail on the head here on this one thing, Bill, and that is that these areas of the world are not sophisticated to understand that global warming is what's causing them to do these things. And if only they would accept global warming as this root of evil, then they wouldn't terrorize anymore.
I mean, it seems so odd. And so we had this huge climate summit in Paris, which I think was a tremendous mistake for a million reasons, other and not just the, you know, the fact that it's ridiculous beyond reasoning, is also the fact that Paris is reeling from a terrorist attack. So what you should do then is put a giant bullseye on the city again and say, hey, come back. You still got, you know, 46 other chumps you can kill here. You know, it's a tremendous burden on the city now that just had a huge terror attack. Tourism is down. Why would you do this to this city? It doesn't bring any money in. All it does is cost money, because it's going to cost tons and tons of police overtime, intelligence gathering, special forces, everything, every logistical thing that you could imagine would go into an event like this normally is now three times worse and more expensive because of what's already happened, and now you've assembled half of the world's leaders in this one place, too.
Yeah, well, that was obviously a great idea.
So, I mean, economically, it seems like a shit show just to begin with, but you factor in the idea that it's ridiculous beyond understanding is makes it even worse. So they have all these, countries here, and they're going to talk about climate change, and they have, by the way, who didn't show up? China.
Oh, you mean
the world's largest polluter.
The number one polluter?
Yeah.
why would they show up? They're not beholden to any other country.
Yeah, they're really not. China doesn't want to be part of the international community. The world didn't even know China existed until 200 years ago. Most of the developed world didn't even know China existed until a couple hundred years ago. So, I mean, the idea that they would want to be part of this is ridiculous. And also the fact that, so like I said, I've been saying this on Twitter for the last couple of days. You cannot have a climate change. You cannot. I mean, let's pretend that this isn't about climate change. Let's just say that this is a conference that maybe some good may come out of it because some pollution will taper off because of a result of some of these restrictions. But let's pretend that it is.
It's not even possible that China, these countries that are the world's leaders in pollution are.
They didn't attend.
But that's the thing. Like they're so bad. There's nothing we can do to mitigate it.
But that's not the point. The point is that if everyone in the world just suddenly decided to emit zero carbon, zero. Let's just pretend for a minute that this is even possible, whether through science or magic. Let's pretend that this happens tomorrow. It's gone. All carbon emissions are gone from all the countries that participate there. India and China, who have already said that, A, they won't participate in the case of China, and India will not make a single concession or do a single thing that they've asked, but they attended anyway because, even with the terrorism, Paris is still better than where they live. So India and China produce 43% of the world's carbon emissions. But they won't do anything about it. So America, UK, Russia, you can make all the concessions that you want. The Chinese are still going to dump mercury into the ocean.
Which is not comforting.
No, it's not. You know what the scariest thing about China is? Do you remember those Chinese watermelons that were exploding that time?
No.
2 years ago, they had watermelons that were imported from China. The FDA let them through. They were the watermelons were treated with some kind of a chemical that got inside the watermelon, into the middle of the watermelon, and it caused some kind of a gas that basically made them expand until they exploded.
That's ridiculous. That can't be true.
No, I'm totally 100% serious. You can look it up.
You send me a link to that.
I'll do it right now. from The Guardian, exploding watermelons put the spotlight on Chinese farming practices. I remember this really, really well. They were exploding, like in people's faces.
That's so weird.
Yeah. And so the point is that you have these countries that not only do they – India – I hate to tell people who have any other opinion of India, it's a dump. It's a dump.
You've been there?
It doesn't matter. You don't have to go there. It's a dump. It's a seventh world country. It's the dirtiest, most polluted country in the world.
Even more polluted than China?
More! Yeah!
Wow.
Almost none of India's rivers or streams are drinkable. None of it's potable. It's all dirt. It's all polluted. There are pictures. You can go look on the internet. There are pictures of rivers. Gigantic
rivers. I
heard that
the cities were overrun where there were shrines to where they have a sacred, like monkeys are sacred, so the monkeys just overtake everything.
Yeah.
So
135 out of the 270 rivers that India has, the water's undrinkable. It's undrinkable, and it's not even safe for animals to swim in.
So what did they do?
It's a good question. They use the ones they have, and they pray the other ones get cleaner someday, somehow.
Yeah.
There are whole rivers in India where they have just crap float, not human waste product floating, but plastic bottles and paper, garbage and all kinds of crap just like floating in the river. And there are pictures. I mean, you can see them on the internet. The Guardian did a really great story about them a couple of years ago. So did the Daily Mail. There's just these whole rivers where in towns where these people depend on drinking water, they have to get the drinking water from, 40 or 50 miles away because the river they have in town is so damn polluted they can't even pee in it. Yeah, I mean, it's bad.
Hey, so what do you suggest we do about the situation in Paris? Because obviously our commander-in-chief isn't going to do anything.
Well, okay, so, we don't have to fight climate change. But places like India, people can't live like this. You can't have a country where 150 of the 270 rivers in the country are undrinkable.
But you can't go into India and tell them how to do their water.
You can't go in there, but maybe we could help them clean it up.
Oh, probably we have tried and they didn't want our help. I mean,
well, maybe we have. I don't know. But you know what? It's better than telling them that a poor, developing, almost pre-industrial country that they have to ditch their only source of energy. And to India's discredit, what their response was, well, you should pay us. That's what they said. India's
so blackmail us.
Yeah,
India's, into compliance, basically.
No, India's representative. No, they don't want to. They don't want to clean it up. What they said was the wealthy countries in the world are all India has a little bit of a problem with socialism. But what they said is all the wealthy countries in the world have destroyed the world, and that's why their country is like it is. And the other countries in the world should just pay them to whatever. Actually, I don't think he even really specified like a resolution. He just, I think his comment was they should pay us. So maybe you're right. Maybe he does want to get paid to clean the stuff up. But
think about it. Like, if you need money to do these procedures, you would ask for the money to do these procedures, right?
Well, I would think that we could do it for them for free. No?
Oh, no, we wouldn't do it for free.
Why not? Bill Gates eliminated malaria with a couple hundred million dollars and of his own money.
Oh, so you're saying, look, we'll come in and we'll do it. We don't have to give you the money. We'll do it. With the people that we send.
We'll do it. We will do it. We're not going to pay you to do it because probably you'll spend the money on drugs.
Yeah.
The same thing you do with homeless people. You don't, you know, if a homeless guy tells you he wants 10 bucks for food, you say, okay, fine. I'll tell you what, I'll go buy you some food and I'll bring it to you.
Yeah. And then they say, no, that's okay.
Yeah.
So that's what you do with India. China's a whole other story because China just doesn't give a shit. China's just a filthy runoff country and they don't give a shit because
I'm hoping that they're coming around, like that the internet is like sinking, like seeping into their culture so that it kind of wears them down over the years to the point where they have to just accept it. Socialism sucks and capitalism rules.
Well, they China is my pipe dream.
Disabuse me of my delusion.
China still has the illusion that the International Monetary Fund is somehow going to replace the yuan, the world's shakiest, most ridiculous, backed by nothing and air currency for the dollar. So, yeah, China's finance minister actually believes that the IMF is going to replace the dollar as the world's reserve currency and use the yuan. I'm not even joking. He really thinks that.
Well, if we keep on having Obama screw things up.
Yeah. Speaking of dreams, I think it's time for the first break.
No, really already?
Yep.
Wow. That was fast.
We will never fully understand what we've asked of our military service members or themselves in harm's way, to endure it all. But we do understand that it's our turn, our duty, to keep them secure for the rest of their lives. Wounded Warrior Project long-term support programs help our most severely ill or injured veterans live independently, at no cost, for life, so that they might stand at ease. Join us at findwwp.org.
Wake up, America.
The biggest threat in those days were from factions seizing control of the governing apparatus and making decisions that were in their interests. Today, we call factions political parties. George Washington himself warned the nation about the dangers of factions in his farewell address.
Office hours with Dr. A, 3 p.m. on Sundays, K98 Talk. We've got something to say to you, America.
We will never fully understand what we've asked of our military service members or their families, asking them to put themselves in harm's way, to endure it all. But we do understand that it's our turn, our duty, to keep them secure for the rest of their lives. Wounded Warrior Project long-term support programs help our most severely ill or injured veterans live independently, at no cost, for life, so that they might stand at ease. Join us at findwwp.org.
The staff of K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network is proud to announce that our very own Rowdy Rick Robinson has been selected as one of the top conservative talk show hosts in the nation for his program, America Off the Rails. Again, congratulations to Rowdy Rick Robinson for a job well done and another reason to stay connected to K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network.
This is Slickery Trigger for Rebel Road Tactical. With proper care and feeding, your pistol will be ready when you need it, there to save your life. Shouldn't your gear be that good? Whether you need a holster for comfortable everyday carry or a tough-as-nails holster for your next training course, Rebel Road Tactical has what you need. Check us out on the web at rebelroadtactical.com.
with whatever the hell this podcast is called this week. Thus far, no glitches.
It's knock on wood.
We're getting there. It's getting there. So let me ask you, do you think that Obama's favorite song is maybe Blame It on the Rain?
Oh my gosh. That is really old. But also by people who were faking it.
Nice. Yeah. And that's sort of what he's doing, isn't he? Faking it.
Yeah, well, you know, he tries.
I think...
I love it when you get that exasperated. that exasperated thing in your voice. It's pretty funny. Anyway, so... I want to ask, I know you wanted to talk about this climate change thing, but I can't really get all that upset about it because that guy's...
I'm not upset about it. I just think it's really funny.
That guy's going to be as... He just keeps doing this stuff that's, you know, irrelevant and tries to distract away from... I mean, I don't know. It's kind of clever, actually. Let's distract away from how incompetent I am by showing how incompetent I am. It's really weird. It's very meta.
Well, I posited that on Twitter, like maybe 4 or 5 days ago, that I sort of think that environmental hysteria is somewhat is somewhat in part created as a scam to divert attention away from meaningless dopey presidents. And the only evidence that I have of that is the global freezing crisis started during Carter's administration.
Oh yeah, that's true. It
global,
is a good song that
global cooling started during Carter. It continued through his years, as long and agonizing as they were.
It was only 4.
I know. 4 of what I would assume are probably the longest years in history.
Yeah, I have no recollection. You were not even born.
No, I wasn't. But I assume living through 8 of Obama, I can't imagine what 4 of Carter was like.
Yeah.
Go with me on this. So the global cooling thing starts during Carter's administration. It ignites what we call the modern environmental movement today. It has nothing to do with ecology or science. It's mostly just based on feels and sadness and possibly a semi-atheistic desire to save something because religion doesn't matter, so let's create our own based on science. And then during Reagan and Bush's years, it just kind of dies out and it goes nowhere. And then now we have a dopey, you know, ridiculous moron of a Democrat as president. And now it's back all of a sudden. No, we don't have to talk about ISIS. Come on, no. The real threat, okay, is dead bees. Think about that.
Well, no, I think it even came up during Clinton because Al Gore was his vice president, and you know that's Al Gore's
on to that. Then
that's Al Gore's claim to fame is his environmentalism.
Well, yes, but that didn't really. That my recollection of that. Is that Gore didn't become...
Well, he wasn't president, so it wasn't as bad.
Well, it didn't become an issue until he ran for president unsuccessfully. I mean, I guess some people, when they suffer a crushing defeat to a person who most would describe as a slack-jawed yokel would, you know, probably just sit and drink or eat themselves to death. Al Gore created a, you know, moronic social, social justice platform for trees.
While flying around in airplanes and having three mansions and cheating on his wife with a masseuse.
Well,
allegedly.
In his defense, have you seen his wife?
No, I haven't. Not recently.
Looks like Heather Locklear got melted in a microwave.
Well, that's awful.
Yeah, just saying. Also, they have like 7 children. Did you know that?
Wow. That's pretty awesome.
Ugh. Not for him, I think. That's a hell of an alimony payment, I would think. Maybe that's why he made Inconvenient Truth. It was like just a way to, it was a way to make some cash to, you know, fund his children. Oh, they have 4 children. I thought it was 7. Who's the one that has 7? There was like one vice president that had like 7 children.
Probably.
Maybe it was Dan Quayle.
Oh.
That's a scary thought, isn't it?
Oh, that'd be awesome. Because at least they would be good looking.
I guess.
You don't have to agree with me. Just accept it's true.
It's funny, though, because now that I'm looking... Excuse me, now that I'm looking at a photo of Al Gore from 1994 on Wikipedia, I remember, I should say, I'm reminded of how terrible he looks now.
Yeah, it's really bad.
Yeah, like he used to look decent-ish for a moron. Now he just looked like a, you know, an average G-man. Now he just looks like he ate all the G-men.
It's so wrong.
It's a job of the Hutt.
Yeah. Anyway. We need to transition to...
I'm supposed to read the part where it says read the transit. We need to transition, but okay.
Yeah, we need to transition to a happier topic.
So Hillary Clinton has 999 problems, but a prison cell ain't one.
Yeah, this is what I want to know. Does Max Blumenthal, is that the guy that she's talking to all the time in her emails?
Sidney Blumenthal.
Oh, Sidney.
Max is his son.
So, but apparently he has another son named Cy who hates Bob Woodward.
Yes, that's true.
What?
I would say that I really want to say, just before you start talking about this, that if anybody who's listening to this doesn't know who... Sidney Blumenthal's son Max Blumenthal is, I would strongly suggest that you look up a picture of him. I swear to you, he looks like a reject from a James Bond villain casting call.
Oh wow.
Yeah, he looks like a villain from a James Bond movie.
Speaking of, I just did see the most recent Bond movie.
Great movie.
Oh, did you think so?
Yeah. Best James Bond movie.
We can have an argument over that.
It's without a doubt the best Daniel Craig Bond film.
No. No. That first one, the first Daniel Craig, was the best Bond movie of all of them. Like, Sean Connery, Pierce Brosnan, Timothy Dalton, Roger Moore, whoever the first guy was...
Connery was the first guy.
Oh, okay. There was a guy in there after him.
You're probably thinking of Who did you say? You said Timothy Dalton, Pierce Brosnan, Sean Connery.
Roger Moore, and there was another guy in there.
George Lazenby.
What's his name?
Yeah, George Lazenby.
Look it up real quick.
Trust me, it's George Lazenby.
Never trust a man who says trust me.
She was holding a drink.
Yeah. What does it say?
A rape on campus taught me that. This is Oni's hold music while she looks it up.
I know, right?
It's great. She provides her own hold music.
I think the first, actually the first James Bond was, I might be wrong, but wasn't it Peter Sellers?
No.
Or was a movie with Peter Sellers, Casino Royale?
That was Casino Royale, but that was after they'd already done like 3 James Bond films.
Really?
Mm-hmm. I have all the Bond films. I have them all on Blu-ray.
This says Casino Royale was made in 1953.
Don't think so. It was made in 1967.
The Casino Royale.
Oh, this is the novels. This is the novels. Sorry. I was reading the wrong section.
That's the book.
What?
Rick was jumping in to provide the fact check.
Yeah, that was the 53 was actually the book. But yeah. Or 56.
It was the wrong part.
I don't think that I'm spoiling anything by talking about Spectre for a couple of seconds here, but...
Oh, you're right. It is George Lazenby.
If you've ever watched a James Bond film or read any of the books and you didn't know that Blofeld was going to be the villain of Spectre, you probably shouldn't watch James Bond films anymore. I mean, it was like so obvious that he was going to be, I mean, they teased it throughout the damn movie. I mean, it was really obvious that he was going to be that he was going to be Blofeld. And I think he was great in that movie. I don't care what anybody says. Christoph Waltz killed in that role.
Yeah, he was great. I'm not disagreeing that it was good for what it was, but of those 4, Casino Royale completely turned the franchise on its head for me. So I got introduced to a whole nother side of James Bond I didn't know existed. It felt like a real spy, what I want James Bond to be, that's what showed up when Daniel Craig showed up.
Yeah, and I don't disagree with that. That Casino Royale was a terrific way to reboot the franchise as a whole. But the whole goal of those 3 movies before that was...
Before Spectre.
Was to get to Spectre.
Yeah.
Everything up until now was leading up to that, because
their
goal to bring Blofeld back and bring him back into the modern age.
And that wasn't really important to me. He was just another villain to me. So
if you're a fan of reading the books, it's probably a little more interesting. It's probably a little more crucial for you. I've read all the books, so it's a little more interesting to me because.
That's what you wanted to see get paid off forever?
No. I think that Blofeld in particular, and Spectre specifically, is what the James Bond franchise was all about and what it should have continued to be. The problem was that really just he couldn't figure out how to continue writing for that, you know, that particular foil for Bond. And so he just kind of gave up on it. And that's why we get terrible movies like that one where he was in the Swiss Alps at the recovery center. And I don't even want to talk about that movie. That was where like Max von Sydow was like Blofeld. That was just awful and stupid. It was.
Which one was that? I'm gonna have to watch it now.
You know, I don't even remember.
You blocked it out. It touched you in the naughty spot to the point where you blocked it out.
I'm trying to remember now which movie it was. It was like maybe it was on Her Majesty's Secret. Yeah, it was Her Majesty's Secret Service.
Wow.
And it wasn't Max von Sydow. I don't know why I said that. It's Telly Savalas. I don't know why I said that. But Telly Savalas plays Blofeld, and he does a terrible job of it.
Well, you're also, I mean, that was a 1969 movie. I mean, it's just not the same type of standard for...
No. You have to watch...
Each child.
Go watch You Only Live Twice. It's the introductory role of... It's the introductory movie for Blofeld.
Okay, I will do.
It's with Donald Pleasance, and he's terrific in the role. And he does it almost exactly like... it's
supposed to be from the book.
Yeah, he does it almost exactly the same way Christoph Waltz played it, or I should say Christoph Waltz played it the same way that Donald Pleasance did, where they just kind of led up to it, and then he just says really casually, "I'm Ernst Stavro Blofeld," and it's like there's, I mean, you have to watch the movie because it's the same deal as all these other previous Bond films with Daniel Craig. You kind of get Blofeld in three or four different movies, but you never see his face, and you just see his hand with the cat.
Yes.
And you see him in like three or four different movies, and then finally they reveal him in Thunderball, and it's great. You Only Live Twice. And it's just Donald Pleasance just hits it out of the park, and it's great. And they save him until like the last 15 minutes of the film, and it's great the way they reveal him.
Well, I think I've only seen those first Sean Connery films.
Yeah, he's in this one.
And then the Roger Moore films, I've seen those, and I don't think I've seen the George Lazenby one.
Oh, I've never seen the George. George Lazenby's only in one film, I think. I don't remember which one it is, but he's only in one film, and it wasn't very good.
Yeah.
Or
I've probably seen all of these movies over time, but I've just, you know, and also I'm not a guy, so I don't get this. It's not the same appeal for me as it is for y'all. So. But because what I loved about Casino Royale was the guy had an actual human motivation to do what he does. He fell in love with a girl, and you know, it was him being human, him being susceptible to emotion. And I'd never seen that really from any of the James Bonds before that. They were all like, you know, yeah, she's a hot dish.
They cover that in the books.
Do they?
Yeah,
because if that is what James Bond is,
Bond is supposed to be.
Then I will read the books. Because up until this point, I thought it was just throwaway chicks and blowing stuff up. Which is fine if you're just, you know, want to watch a show on a Saturday night. But what I want from an actual movie or book is a story, is something that I can sink my teeth into, I guess.
Well, in the books they talk about how his backstory is revealed slowly throughout the course of the first four books.
Well, no, you've convinced me. You don't have to tell me anymore.
Well, yeah, I'm just saying.
Convince me if the Casino Royale is like what these books are about, then I will totally read them.
Yeah, yeah. It's basically he's dealing with two separate issues, which is the fact that his parents both died and he's a ward of that guy who, you know, from Spectre. And then there's also the fact that it's not the same as in the books, but he did have this woman that, like, he was engaged to or something, and she was murdered or something like that. And that's sort of where all this, like, kind of goes.
Yeah. I'm definitely going to have to read them now, so. I love that Le Chiffre. That guy that played Le Chiffre was amazing.
Anyway, so now that we have 10 minutes left, because we were talking about that.
Well, there's nothing wrong with that. It's, you know, we can't be all doom and gloom and Obama's fault for everything. We got to diverge into some fun stuff.
Thanks,
well,
Obama.
I agree. So. Speaking of fun stuff.
Fun stuff.
Speaking of fun stuff, here's a Hillary Clinton email.
You found one.
Subject, responding. Dear Hank, when I switched BlackBerries last week, I lost a bunch of emails, including yours. But as I recall, you asked if I would be a reference for you. Blank, 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 blank. Of course, I would be delighted. So please, send whatever info I may need to draft a letter extolling your many virtues. I'm copying Rob Russo, my assistant who works on matter like this for me, so you will have two email addresses in case mine goes kaput again.
What?
So you see, Hillary Clinton even loses her own emails. What the hell?
Well, and she even admits she has more than one email account there.
Yes, she does.
So ridiculous.
Yeah, even Hillary loses her own emails, which I thought was all sorts of great.
Who's Hank?
I don't know. Hank, let's see.
I like
Hank,
the name.
Where are you? Hank, where are you? Where'd you go?
What does
it say?
Is it short for Henry?
Hank Naughton.
Hank Naughton?
It says Harold. It says the emails to Harold Naughton. So I just
Short for Harold.
I don't know how that works, but whatever.
Well, that's the same as Jack being short for John. How does that even make sense?
I don't know. Or Bill and William. Or Jim and James. I mean, how does any of that stuff make sense?
Well, so, but Jim and James, I mean, that makes sense to me because James is so formal and Jim's informal. But Jack and John are the same to me. And you're not saving any letters.
I don't get it. Speaking of saving letters.
Hillary's emails?
No. Speaking of saving letters, we have a story on Weasel Zippers. Yes, that I inspired, but somebody else wrote because I noticed it, and someone else wrote the story because I'm
you
lazy.
Said, here's the tip.
Number of times.
Oh my God! Can we blot that out?
No. Number of times White House has tweeted about Rosa Parks, 5. Number of pictures of Rosa Parks actually used, 0. So one of the guy that owns Weasel Zippers was saying to me today, did we do this post already, meaning there was a tweet sent out by the White House official Twitter account. 60 years ago today, Rosa Parks changed America. It's a picture of Obama sitting on Rosa Parks' bus in her seat, or the seat she refused to give up, rather. And, you know, you've seen the picture. Of course.
With that pensive stare out the window.
Ooh, pensive. That's an SAT word. So
it's a Harry Potter word.
Okay, that works. So he says to me, did we do this story already? This picture looks familiar to me. And I said, yeah, it should. And he goes, why? And I said, well, because the White House has been tweeting that picture for the last 3 years. Every year.
It's the same picture?
Yes. Every year for the last 3 years, we went back and we looked. 2015, 2014, 2012, twice in 2012. They commemorated an event related to or the birthday of Rosa Parks.
Oh, yeah.
This exact same image. Yes.
So why couldn't they use a picture of Rosa Parks? I don't understand why they need to always use Obama.
I don't know.
It's weird, right? I mean, I would think you would want to put, but I mean, this is the thing. For a long time in America, families used to put a picture of their president on their walls. Like, I would never do that, but you know, some people did. Like, they had pictures of Ike on their walls.
We had a picture of George W. Bush in our house, and my grandfather hated him.
Wow.
Yeah.
Look, I have a trivet that has George W. Bush on it, but...
Okay, then.
That's different. That's not him on a wall. And what were the other... I've seen for, like... And, like, JFK... was in people's houses on walls, and they're probably still on people's houses and walls, or on walls and houses. But
I, you know, it's, but yes, it is a little odd, I admit. We have a tradition on the blog of posting stories that are Barack Obama commemorates next event with picture of Barack Obama.
You have a whole section dedicated to
yes,
to
it's
that?
A whole category. It's a, wow, it's an actual awesome category on the blog called Obama Commemorates.
I'm glad that you guys have undertaken this duty.
Yeah, oh, it's great. I love it. There's probably about 1,000 of those stories now.
Wow.
Anyway, it's getting close to closeout time, so...
Yeah, sorry we didn't talk about whatever else you wanted to talk about.
I don't remember what the other thing was anymore.
James Bond is far superior a topic.
Yeah, I agree. Just remember, welcome to America. Fuck off. We're full.
We're full.
Good night, everybody.
Good night. Good night, Rick.
Good night.
When our water heater broke down last month, it was a nightmare. It took 5 hours for the plumber to show up, and he charged us a couple of $100 just to come out. Then it cost another $1,800 to put in the new water heater. By the time it was all said and done, I felt like I'd been taken. But what else could I do?
The smartest thing you can do is get a home warranty from American Residential Warranty. Their home warranties pay to repair or replace all your major appliances when they break, and they will break, and at the worst possible time. Call American Residential Warranty right now for free information on home warranties starting at just pennies a day. Don't wait for your refrigerator to stop running or your ceiling fans to stop turning. Call American Residential Warranty right now. Ask how you can save up to 50% on washer and dryer coverage. Just call 1-800-513-6154. That's 1-800-513-6154. Again, 1-800-513-6154. Call now.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.